Black Ops Talk.
Black Ops Talk.
No, it was live. We prepared yesterday night, so we'll see.
And that's why you weren't here.
Maybe I don't know.
I do anything. Recording.
Ah, for recording.
Everything you say can be used against you.
Okay, perfect.
Put it somewhere in the middle. No, this is too high.
Here. Ah, here. Okay.
And when you get here, just take off your smartphone.
Sorry? Yeah, in fact, that is the first thing I will do. If I say something illegal, stop me before it's too late. In Italy now, there is this habit, since with a smartphone you can record everything. Yeah. I have unauthorized videos and recording of my lectures. They don't even ask, they just make videos.
Yeah. Nowadays.
Sorry?
But you were not here, so.
Ah, yeah, of course, yeah. No, but Friday is better. It's a responsibility to give a talk last day. Sorry? I don't know. So there is only one USB. opposite, yeah. Maybe you put your finger here because otherwise it's really tricky. Okay. Sorry. Okay. Maybe if you copy on the desktop is better, just in case there is something wrong with the USB. Okay. Yeah, okay, great. Yes. But so do they record even during breaks?
Oh, yes, of course, all the jokes.
So I should have been more careful. Okay, right? Okay, here?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for the introduction, so, and thanks to the organizers for the invitation. Okay, yes, there is a question. I'll give an answer, but you may not like the answer, of course. So yesterday we had the Lorentzian day. Today we come back to Riemannian and compact manifolds. So sorry for that, but yeah, we rotated back to Riemannian compact manifolds. So this talk is based on a joint work with Ludwig Dabrowski, which will appear soon, we hope, on Journal of Non-Commutative Geometry. And the keywords are, of course, a standard model, Morita equivalence, and of course, finite dimensional spectral tribus. So what I'm going to talk about, the content of the paper was, so first I will recall an algebraic characterization of Dirac spinors. There are many spectral triples that you can attach to a manifold. In particular, one, if it is a spin, the one associated to a spin structure. So there is an algebraic way to characterize exactly this. And this is what I will recall, this algebraic characterization. What we did was to try to apply this to the finite dimensional spectral triple of the standard model. And to understand if it satisfies such a condition, so if it is the analog of the spectral triple of a spin structure, or if not, if one can modify it a little bit in order to make it satisfy this condition. So the first part of the talk will be, again, sorry, about introductory material on spectral triples that you heard so many times this week. But it is just to fix notation, and I will be very quick. So, spectral triples again. Since I'm going to talk about Morita equivalence, it is convenient in this case to adopt the following notation. For me, only for today, a spectral triple will be a unital C-star algebra. So, here A is not just a star algebra, but a C-star algebra. Concretely represented by bounded operators on a complex Hilbert space. And of course, our operator D self-adjoint with compact resolvent, and the condition can be on commutators can be rephrased in the following way: you can ask that the subalgebra of Lipschitz elements that are those with bounded commutators with D, you ask that this subalgebra is dense in A. Okay, what are examples? There is one example. Which is very important to us, is given this class of example is given by finite dimensional spectral triples, which we may interpret as finite non-commutative spaces. If your Hilbert space is finite dimensional, you can take any algebra of operators on this Hilbert space and any bounded operator D, and you get a spectral triple. In this particular case, every element is a Lipschitz element, so the initial C-star algebra and this small subalgebra are the same. At some point, I will focus on only finite non-commutative spaces because that is what I'm interested in the example of the standard model. So this is the first family of example. Note that the C-star algebra may be real or complex, and in the standard model case is real. Then there are many other examples associated to manifolds. So let me remember how this construction works, which is very general. Suppose you have a manifold M. So first of all, Riemannian manifold, I will always assume that it is compact, oriented, and no boundary. On this manifold, to construct a spectral triple, you need a vector bundle, E2 over M. So in particular, this must be Hermitian, because you want to construct a Hilbert space out of sections, equipped with a unitary Clifford action, which is an action basically of one forms on sections on the vector bundle. And it must be equipped with a connection compatible with the metric. If you have all this data, then you can construct a spectral triple in the standard way. You take the algebra of continuous function. This is our sister algebra. You take square integrable sections as Hilbert space, and the Dirac type operator is the composition of the connection with the Clifford multiplication. So there are several important examples of this kind, which give each of them provide important geometrical informations about the space. And here I wrote four of them, but I want to mention only two. Well, there is of course the example, the spectral triple coming from a spin structure. If I'm in spin, you have your spinor bundle, and you have your Dirac operator, and you get the canonical spectral triple of a spin manifold. Another example which is important and appears, for example, in the reconstruction theorem is the one given by the Hodge, let me call it Hodge spectral triple. In this case, your Hilbert space is given by square integrable by differential forms, but you complete them into an Hilbert space, so square integrable sections of some vector bundle. the Dirac operator is the differential plus the adjoint, which is what we call Hodge operator, and this is another example of spectral triple. This is even, so there is a grading, whatever is the dimension on of M. Okay, in all these examples, so whatever is the vector bundle E, in all these examples, the Hilbert space H, I don't know if you read this law, okay, the Hilbert space H carries not only a representation of the algebra of functions, which I denote here by A, but also a representation of the Clifford algebra of the Riemannian manifold. So this Clifford action tells you it is an action of one forms on this space, in fact bounded, and what is generated by this action is indeed this algebra here, is a concrete representation of the Clifford algebra. And these two representations are commuting, one commuting with the other, and this will be important in the following. So last example of spectral triple that I mention really quickly is the spectral triple which appear in the standard model, in the derivation of the standard model from non-commutative geometry. Here, skipping the details, you have a product, as you have already seen, of a manifold, so a continuous part and a finite non-commutative space. In particular, the manifold is assumed to be a spin manifold, and you take the canonical spectral triple associated to the spin structure. And on the finite space, you consider a spectral triple that allows you to recover the physics, basically. So all the data, the algebra, the space, Dirac operator, and grading and real structure that I will mention later, all this data comes basically, you can justify it mathematically, but basically you know what you want to obtain. So the Hilbert space must contain, give you the correct number of fermions. The representation of the algebra is such that you recover, the algebra and its representation are such that you recover the correct gauge group with the correct representation. And in particular, so the Hilbert space is graded, for example, by the chirality operator, and in particular the Dirac operator of the finite part is what encodes the free parameters of the theory, so masses, coupling constants, and so on. Okay, and this is the last example. Let us come back. So a little bit more, let me recall the zeros and first order condition. I'm going a little bit fast on this because these are all things that you have already seen. So if you have a spectral triple, you call it real if there is an antilinear isometry J on the Hilbert space. This J satisfies some commutation relations with D and the gamma and the grading, and satisfies two more conditions that are written here, the reality or zeroth order condition and the first order condition, which I think you saw already in at least three talks this week, so I'm not going to explain them. Okay, I mentioned this because I want to, as I said, a part of this talk was to recall, an important part of this talk was to recall an algebraic characterization of Dirac spinors. So let me quickly come back to the geometric examples. You have several examples, important examples of spectral triples attached to Riemannian manifolds. And you may wonder how can you distinguish, for example, this, the spectral triple with a true Dirac operator from, for example, this, the spectral triple with Hodge Dirac operator. So what I'm going to recall is the algebraic characterization of this one, and then I will say something really a little bit about this, the Hodge spectral triple. So for this algebraic characterization, I had to recall what a real structure is, and then I can state the following theorem. So sorry, I didn't put references here, but you can find, of course, all the references in my paper with Ludwig. And this is a theorem that is, for example, in Varilli's book on the one published with AMS, for example, probably even in the Green Book. So first part of the theorem. If you have a Riemannian manifold M, again oriented, compact, and a boundary, so then M has a spin-C structure. If and only if there exists a Morita equivalence by module sigma between the algebra of continuous functions and the Clifford algebra on the manifold. So, spin-C structure exists only if and only if there is such a bimodule. I'm not recalling now what is Morita equivalence, but we'll talk about it later. Second part of the statement, if you have such a bimodule sigma, this is in fact a finitely generated projective. By Sars-1 theorem, you know that it is given by continuous sections of some vector bundle of an M. So then you can construct, you can actually construct this vector bundle. The proof of Sars-1 theorem is constructive. This vector bundle turns out to be exactly the spinor bundle, which is in the geometric, standard differential geometric sense. So elements of this vector bundle, actually sections of these vector bundles, so the elements of the bimodule sigma is what we call Dirac spinors on the manifold. Then you have your spinor bundle S. Once you have it, you can canonically introduce the Dirac operator D. So there is a canonical connection compatible with the metric. There is a Hermitian structure on the bimodule sigma, and there is a Clifford action. So you can construct your Dirac operator. And you may wonder when, so now up to here, what we have is the Hilbert space, sections of the spinor bundle, our Dirac spinors, the Dirac operator, and our algebra of continuous functions. So this is a spectral triple. We may wonder when the spin C manifold is spin. And the last part of the theorem says that M is a spin manifold if and only if this spectral triple is real. So there is a real structure in the sense that we all know. So let me repeat again. So spin C manifold means that you have the inside your Hilbert space of your spectral triple, you have some dense subspace which establish a Morita equivalence between these two objects. So this is spin C. Spin is, in addition, you need a real structure. And this is what we want to generalize to non-commutative algebras to define, to give a definition of what we mean by Dirac spinors. It's a straightforward, what I'm going to give is a straightforward generalization, but I think it is a natural one. So now let me assume that for the following definition, let me assume that the Hilbert space is finite dimensional, because here you see in your spectral triple you have some Hilbert space, but the Morita equivalence bimodule is not the whole Hilbert space, it's something dense in it. Since I want to avoid all these technical, technical details, and since at the end I'm interested in the finite space of the standard model in the finite part, because the continuous part is clear what it is. So in the following definition, I will assume that the spectral triple is finite dimensional. Okay, in particular, is the spectral triple finite dimensional? You don't have to distinguish between the sister algebra and the Lipschitz subalgebra, they coincide. And you can use Morita equivalence is the ring theoretic one, the easiest one, let me say. But of course, the generalization to infinite dimensional case of all this is something, it is clear what it is. It's not difficult, just a bit longer. The definitions are a bit longer. Okay, we have a spectral triple given by an algebra, Hilbert space and the Dirac operator. We know what is the analog of one forms. The vector space of one forms associated to these spectral triples is the subspace of bounded operators, which is spanned by the following elements. You take commutators of D with an element B in the algebra, and you multiply by another element in the algebra. So this would be an exact one form. You multiply by an element in the algebra and you get, when you take the linear span, you get all one forms. So again, this is true for finite dimensional spectral triples. Then according to my definition, if H is not finite dimensional, here you should take Lipschitz elements, so not all elements in the sister algebra. And okay, with the initial definition I gave of spectral triples, if here you put the Lipschitz subalgebra, here you will get, in this case, Lipschitz sections of the cotangent bundle. So maybe it's not really the usual thing one works with. It's not just smooth sections. But in the finite dimensional case, it's okay. All these objects coincide. Okay, once you have one form, so you can define the analog of the Clifford algebra. This definition is similar to one that appeared in a paper by Lord, Renier, and Varilli in Journal of Geometry and Physics in 2012. It's a very natural definition. The one I'm going to give is not exactly the one they give. I think that if the spectral triple is even, then the definition is exactly the same. If it is odd, they double the algebra for some reason, because they want something graded. Okay, what I denote by Clifford D of A, so the Clifford algebra associated to the spectral triple, this is just the algebra of bounded operators on the Hilbert space, which is generated by A and by one forms, and if the spectral triple is even, I put in the list of generators also the grading gamma. So note that gamma is already contained, the grading is already contained in the algebra generated by A and omega 1. It is already contained in this algebra if the spectral triple is orientable, because the orientability condition is the fact that you can express this as in fact, not only a cochain, so some tensor in some tensor power, some element in some tensor power of omega 1, but in fact, a cocycle, something that when is represented. Gamma is the representation of some Hochschild or cyclic cocycle. So here I'm not assuming orientability, and in fact the spectral triple, the finite spectral triple of the standard model, one can check that, the one with a neutrino mixing doesn't satisfy orientability. So you have to put by hand the grading in this algebra. If you think to the simplest possible example, which is not compact, but okay, forgive me for this, Rn, for example, R4 with Euclidean flat metric. So here you have functions. Here you have functions multiplied by gamma matrices. So this thing is generated by functions, gamma matrices, and this is gamma 5, which is already a product of elements here in the manifold case. Okay, now that we have that I said what the Clifford algebra is, I can rephrase in a very simple way, in a very concise way, both the reality and first order condition. I'm going to use the same notation that you have already seen also yesterday, I think. So I will denote by a circle. We have a unital real spectral triple. I will denote by a circle the image of the algebra A under this map. So the set of elements J, A star, J minus 1, where little a is an element of the algebra capital A. So this is basically the opposite algebra, but which I identify with its concrete representation on the Hilbert space. So with this notation, reality and first order condition are simply the statement that this A circle, the opposite algebra, belongs to the commutant of the Clifford algebra, meaning that these elements commute with both functions and with one form. So if they commute with functions and one form, so they commute, of course, with the gradient, and so you are inside the commutant of the Clifford algebra. So this in red is the reality and first order condition together. And now I can try to give a tentative definition of Dirac spinors, which is something that somebody might not like, but this is the definition we are working with. So what is a Dirac spinor? We could say that elements of the Hilbert space are Dirac spinors if this inclusion here is inequality. So not only the opposite algebra is in the commutant of the Clifford algebra, but the two coincide. So again, you can rephrase this by saying that your Hilbert space is a Morita equivalence by module between the algebra of your spectral triple of functions on the non-commutative space and the associated Clifford algebra. This is our tentative definition of Dirac spinors, which is called property M in the paper, but I'm just calling Dirac condition here. And this one, the one that we want to use to study, in particular, the example of the standard model. So before coming back to the standard model, so this condition, Morita equivalence between functions and the Clifford algebra is what characterizes the canonical spectral triple of a spin manifold, so Dirac spinors and the actual Dirac operator. Let me say something also about this. This is a part which is not in the paper, but I just want to make some comments based on discussions with people here at the conference. So is there a similar characterization of the Hodge spectral triple? And now we go back. Well, it's not exactly a characterization, but we can say something. What are the algebraic properties of the Hodge spectral triple? So, first of all, in all the four geometric examples we saw before, if you take the commutator of the Dirac operator with a function, you get a Clifford multiplication by the differential of the function. In the Hodge example, I recall this because now will be important. In the Hodge example, the Hilbert space, you may think of it in two ways, as some completion of the vector space of differential forms, and here the product is not important, just a vector space I'm interested in, or you can think of it as a completion of the Clifford algebra, because forms, differential forms and the Clifford algebra, they are the same vector space but with a different product. In fact, you may think of this as a quantization of this in a proper mathematical sense. So the Hilbert space is just a completion of the Clifford algebra. The abstract Clifford algebra in the sense of spectral triple, again, is the usual Clifford algebra of differential geometry. And what is the representation? So this is represented here. Forms act by Clifford multiplication here. So if you adopt this point of view, here the Clifford multiplication becomes just the multiplication from the left of the algebra on itself. So in the Hodge example, you have a Clifford algebra represented on itself by left multiplication. So what is the real structure? You can put a real structure on the spectral triple given simply by the involution, either on forms or here. You take J of a vector in the Hilbert space is just the conjugate. And in particular, this means that if you look at the circled algebra, if B is the Clifford algebra and B circle is JBJ minus 1, this is just the Clifford algebra acting here from the right, so by multiplication from the right. So in the spectral triple, we have all the natural structure that we would expect. You have the Clifford algebra acting on itself from the left and from the right. And in fact, up to completion, the Hilbert space is a self-Morita equivalence by module. Okay, so why I mention this? I want just to make a connection with some of previous talks. So if I understood correctly the first version of order two condition, which was in one of the first papers by Shane, by Boyle and Farnsworth. So the first version of the second order condition was the condition that the left and right action of the Clifford algebra on the Hilbert space commute. So it means so you may say that a real spectral triple satisfies the second order condition if the Clifford algebra circled, so acting through J, is in the commutant of the Clifford algebra acting from the left. So this is another way to phrase it. In the OG example, you have something more. You don't have just this inclusion, but you have equality. So the commutant of the Clifford algebra acting from the left is exactly the Clifford algebra acting from the right. So Morita equivalence appears again. And you may say, again, this is a really tentative definition. It's just for this talk, but you could say that elements of your Hilbert space are Hodge spinors, so the analog of what you have in the Hodge spectral triple, if this inclusion is an equality, if the commutant of the Clifford algebra is the Clifford algebra itself. Again, this, say, for example, in the finite dimensional case, to avoid problems with completions, otherwise it is a bit longer. And also, I have to say that this is not a characterization. In the case of Dirac spinors, it was really an algebraic characterization, a theorem saying you have a spin C structure if and only if there is a Morita equivalence. Here, we don't have any, I don't think there are theorems of this kind, but again, since I inserted these two slides like yesterday, I don't know if this is something that was studied. The analog of the theorem that I showed for Dirac spinors in the case of the Hodge-Dirac operator and its associated spectral triple. Okay, last remarks. There are two observations that one can make. What if we impose, we have a spectral triples and we want it to satisfy both the Dirac condition and the second order condition? Well, if the two are satisfied, so if the Dirac condition is satisfied and also the second order condition, then you can easily prove that this is an equality. So the Hodge condition is also satisfied. Why it is an equality? On one side, the Clifford algebra circled is inside the commutant of the Clifford algebra. On the other side, this must be equal to a circle. Now, here and here, you can remove the circle because conjugation by J is an invertible map, is an algebra morphism. So the Clifford algebra is inside A, but the opposite inclusion is trivial, is by construction, and so the two must be equal. So Dirac plus second order implies this such condition, but in fact implies more. If the Clifford algebra is equal to A, in fact, you can say that the Hilbert space is a self-Morita equivalence A by modulo. So not only implements a self-Morita equivalence for the Clifford algebra, but also for the algebra of functions. So from a non-commutative geometry point of view, you can say that this is a line bundle. One example where all this condition is satisfied, maybe it's a trivial one, but is from a mathematical point of view, but is physically interesting, is the one given by the finite spectral triple of the Einstein-Young-Mills theory, where the algebra is a matrix algebra, the Hilbert space is A, J is conjugation, and this is equal to zero. And you can check that everything is satisfied. This is clearly a self-Morita equivalence A by module, and so on. Okay, this was just a parenthesis, and I will say just one more thing on this later. Let's come back to the standard model. Yes? Sorry, I can hear a bit loud. Well, this is an example. What is used in this, say, physical models is d equal to zero. But in order to satisfy all these conditions, you can satisfy all of them with d different from zero. So you can have this equality even with d different from zero. The trivial example is d is the identity in the finite dimensional case and these two concepts. I'm sure there are even non-trivial examples, but okay. But clearly, if you impose all these conditions together, the result will be a bit trivial. But H, for example, a self-Morita equivalence by module can be, doesn't have to be necessarily the algebra itself. It can be sections of a line band, non-trivial line band. But of course, when you have this equality, so commutator of D with A is still an M element of the algebra, so it's an inner derivation. And, okay. is maybe not really interesting because we are imposing really a lot of condition altogether. But this was just a remark that I wanted to make. Now we'll I will immediately forget about the second order condition and focus on this one, because this is what is in the paper. Okay, so back to the standard model. So what I want to discuss is the spectral triple describing the dynamics of elementary particles in the standard model of particle physics. As I said, this is the product of two pieces. There is a spin manifold M and a finite non-commutative space F. And if you look at the continuous part, so this is a spin manifold, and the spectral triple that you consider is the one associated to the spin structure. So elements of the Hilbert space of the continuous part are really Dirac spinors. So a natural question, at least me and Ludwig thought it was an interesting question, is what about the finite part? So here you take Dirac spinors, what are the elements of the Hilbert space which is on the right? So you may wonder, for example, if the finite Hilbert space is a Morita equivalence by module between A and the Clifford algebra, with or without J. So you have the analog of a spin or spin C structure. And this is what I'm going to talk about and what is in the paper with Ludwig. You could also wonder whether this is the analog of a Hodge spectral triple. So if the Hilbert space is a self-Morita equivalence by module for the Clifford algebra. And this is something we started discussing basically yesterday, so it's really, I wouldn't call it, it's work in progress with a question mark. Oh, sorry. Okay. Yeah, question mark on progress, not on on the names, of course. I'm sure about the names. Okay, so the question is, what kind of non-commutative space is the one on the right? Is it a spin manifold, a spin C, or just see, for example, in the last model where you drop the reality condition, you could say that this is maybe just an orientable Riemannian manifold, the finite non-commutative analog. On an orientable Riemannian manifold, you don't have necessarily. Well, okay, maybe. I shouldn't have said that. In the Hodge spectral triple, you still have a real structure, but okay. Okay, so what I want to talk about is this second condition. I want to understand if elements in the finite Hilbert space of this spectral triple, in the finite part, if they are the analog of Dirac spinors, and which precisely mean, besides the name Dirac spinor, which may or may not be appropriate, it means I want to understand if it is a Morita equivalence by module, the Hilbert space between the algebra A and the Clifford algebra. And this is what is in the paper. So what, so sorry, okay. So you can forget about everything else. You forget about the last line because this is a work in progress. So you should not work on this before us. So forget the last line. Okay, let me make another comment of these conditions. If you start imposing condition on, of course, on a spectral triple, this condition put constraints on the object involved, in particular on the Dirac operator. So remember that the Dirac operator, now I'm focusing on the finite part of the spectral triple of the standard model, so the continuous part I'm not interested in it anymore, and DF is the Dirac operator. So whatever this DF is, remember that this contains the encodes the dynamics, in some sense, it contains the free parameters of the theory. And when you impose, for example, that the spectral triple is even, or that it is satisfies the first order, or even the second order condition, you put constraints on these free parameters. What kind of constraints? So the three that I mentioned, parity, first order, and second order condition, if you impose this condition, they tell you that some matrix element in the Dirac operator must be zero. So for example, this means from a physical point of view that you are excluding some kind of interactions. So if I'm not wrong now about the physics, for example, you can check that the parity condition excludes, the first order condition allows you to exclude a vertex like this, annihilation of two electrons. So this is a first kind of constraints that tells you that some elements in the Dirac operator should be zero. Of course, everything can be zero. You can take the zero Dirac operator, like in the Einstein-Young-Mills models, and the spectral triple conditions are satisfied. All these conditions are trivially satisfied. So the conditions, the Morita involving Morita equivalence, these in some way are the opposite in spirit to this here. Both the condition that elements of HF are Dirac spinors, but even the condition that they are Auger spinors, this condition imply that in general, in the Dirac operator, some matrix element should be different from zero. I say in general because then it depends on the specific examples. But intuitively, if you want that your Hilbert space is a Morita equivalence by module between two algebras, one of the two is the Clifford algebra, so the Clifford algebra cannot be too small. If D is zero, the Clifford algebra is as small as it can be. So this, if you require that element of HF are Dirac spinors, this means that your Clifford algebra cannot be too small, and what you will get is that some elements in the Dirac operator, if you want this to be satisfied, cannot be zero. So it, in some sense, these two are opposite in spirit. It would be very nice to combine these two kind of conditions and predict something about the Dirac operator. Possibly something which is not in disagreement with experiment, but okay. Okay, so maybe I can skip this. So what is the result in the paper with Ludwig? There are a series of mathematical statements. The first mathematical statement is that assume that the algebra, the Hilbert space, and the real structure are the one that, that we know. In particular, the real structure is given by charge conjugation. And assume that the grading is given by the chirality operator, which is also the grading used in the original Chamsden-Cohn approach. So with this data, whatever is the Dirac operator, there is no Dirac operator compatible, in particular with this grading, satisfying the Dirac condition. Then you can interpret this in several ways, but for me it's just a mathematical statement. You might say that maybe the Dirac operator should be modified, or you can also say simply that, okay, this finite non-commutative space is not the analog maybe of a spin manifold, but it is what it is. So anyway, the mathematical statement is that if the grading is the chirality, there exists no compatible Dirac operator such that you get Dirac spinors. So what if the grading is not the chirality? So you can classify actually all possible gradings compatible with this fixed algebra, Hilbert space, and real structure, and there are not so many of them. It depends on a very small number of signs. The grading, the minimal modification of grading that we considered with Ludwig in the last part of the paper is the following one. You take the operator which on particles is given not just by the chirality, but the chirality multiplied by B minus L, where B is the boson number and L is the lepton number. Baryon number, sorry. Again, I wrote this last night, so I apologize. So, yeah, the baryon number minus the lepton number. Okay, with this chirality, it is possible to satisfy the Dirac condition. So, in fact, what we show is we provide both a theorem with a necessary condition, saying if this Dirac operator satisfying this Dirac condition, then at least these elements we specify which one should be non-zero. The exact statement I didn't copy on the slide, you can find it in the paper, but so the spirit of one theorem is that we provide a necessary condition, so which element should be different from zero in order for this condition to be satisfied. And we also provide a theorem with sufficient conditions. So we show that there are choices of the Dirac operator which satisfy this Morita equivalence condition. This Dirac operator will not be the one given by Chance-Lincoln, but is a very minimal modification. The minimal modification that you can make is adding exactly two terms in the Dirac operator. But at least these two terms must be added and different from zero. So, okay, I will skip this. You know we already talked about this. In the original spectral triple, there was a problem with the X mass. This is just a comment, a final comment that I want to make, but probably already, surely Fedele talked about this, right? So, in the original spectral triple provided by Chance-Lincoln, the X mass is not a free parameter, was predicted, but the value was ruled out by experiments. So then several modifications were suggested in order to find the correct value of the X mass, I list here four. So you can enlarge the Hilbert space, and this means that you introduce new fermions. You can turn one element of the Dirac operator into a field, the element describing Majorana mass of the neutrino, which is the part of D commuting with both the algebra and the opposite algebra. You can relax the first order condition, so this allow, if you don't impose the first order condition, you can put more non-zero element in the Dirac operators or enlarge, if you want, the algebra. Or another approach is the one by Fedele, Pierre, and Agostino Devastato of ground symmetries combined with twisted spectral triples. So in the last three approaches, when you fluctuate the metric, you get the Majorana mass term becomes of the neutrino becomes a new scalar field. So the last comment I wanted to mention, which probably was already mentioned by Fedele, is that imposing the Dirac condition, you find that you must add two terms to I call this Chance-Lincoln Dirac operator, but of course many people worked with this. You must add at least two terms, and this must be not zero. In particular, one of the two terms is really close to this scalar field, but close means nothing, of course, from a physical point of view, I mean. And there is another term which couples leptons with quarks. These are the two terms that you find. So physical implications are under investigation, and Fedele talked about this. And let me just mention that this second term, although one may say that maybe it is very ugly or it should disappear in some way and so on, this term in the Dirac operator is exactly what you need if you want, for example, the spectral triple to be irreducible. So another of the axioms of non-commutative geometry was irreducibility. That means that in the Hilbert space, there is no proper subspace. I mean, you cannot decompose the Hilbert space as direct sum of two pieces, each one carrying a spectral triple structure, so a sub-representation of the algebra, closed under the action of the Dirac operator, and so on. In the standard model, if you decompose HF as the fermionic part and the bosonic part, you get two separate subspectral triples. So in order to make the spectral triple irreducible, you need exactly in the Dirac operator a term that connects the bosonic part and the fermionic part. Again, this may be... okay. The bosonic and leptonic part, the baryonic and leptonic part, leptoquark, so leptonic and baryonic part, which may be a really unpleasant term from physical point of view, so maybe the conclusion is just that irreducibility is not one of the conditions which is satisfied by this example. So thanks for your attention. I don't know if you have time. For the finite part. Yeah, of course. I mean, with the algebra C plus H plus M3C. If you take.
Let's take polysum.
Yeah, that is irreducible, okay.
Yeah, but then the question is, do you have a Dirac condition?
Okay, in that case, we discussed this in the paper, although we wrote this 1 year ago, so I'm not sure I remember the answer. But in Patisalan model, I think you cannot talk about this Dirac condition because it is already not satisfied the first order condition, which is the first step with the Dirac operator, again, what I call the Chamberlain conic, the usual. So, because the Dirac condition is, this is the condition that the opposite algebra is the commutant of the Clifford algebra. If this is satisfied, in particular, this is satisfied. The first order and reality are satisfied. So, if you don't have this, it makes no sense to discuss this.
Andre?
Yeah.
In sort of previous approaches, I mean, one considered an equivalent formulation of what is a spin structure. Mm. I mean, not spin C, but spin structures, sort of irreducible spectral triple with J.
Yeah.
And that proved to be correct when you study, well, say, length spaces or some other manifolds,
yeah,
that the classification of those things corresponds to the classification of spin structures. Is this equivalent to the formulation with Morita equivalence or not?
So the theorem. Yeah, so here the theorem doesn't mention irreducibility. So here irreducibility is not involved. The theorem is just that spin C structure is the same as Morita equivalence by module, but probably... Yeah, and the spin is spin C plus J. Also here there is no mention to irreducibility, but then in this case it's automatically irreducible, the spectral triple. So, but we didn't impose irreducibility, we imposed only this condition.
So if you don't impose irreducibility, you get more in the classical case?
No, in the classical case it's automatically irreducible. If it is, if these conditions are satisfied, then you get the usual canonical spectral triple, which is, I think, is irreducible, right? Yeah.
Then this implies irreducibility. Okay, yeah,
yeah,
that was my question.
Yeah, I was not sure. I was going to say something like this, but so it is, of course, irreducible, a representation combined of these two algebras. Here, the Dirac operator is involved, so. But you say that it is a theorem even in the non-commutative case, or?
I don't know about that.
Yeah. Okay, so that is, where is the grading? Sorry. Sorry, I don't find the grading.
What's the result of the fermionic action?
Well, that is the part which is a work in progress by Fedele and...
select kind of different representations.
So, no, okay. So let me answer to this. Here you can do two things. You can use this to project the Hilbert space, or you can use a different approach. First, you weak rotate, in this way you eliminate simultaneously some degrees of freedom, which mathematically means you are using basically this to project the chirality. So if you take the Dirac operator compatible with this, but you project using the chirality, the terms, some extra term automatically go away. Well, the projection is more complicated because you look at the full Hilbert space.
Sure, so you take the projection corresponding to gamma 5 tensor gamma f?
Projection.
Just in, yeah. Okay.
So the projection says...
Yes, that
you get it. Eyes of the beholder.
No, that you get it from the data that you already have, which is the current, is the grading,
yeah.
Which is, it should be gamma phi tensor gamma f.
Or yeah, yeah. Yeah, you get two different results. Either you take this grading or you still use the chirality. But one considers the projection is a part outside the non-commutative geometry because you want to remove unphysical degrees of freedom. Yeah, but mathematically you can do these two things. You either use this or still use the chirality, which is the physical in some sense one. I don't know which one is more. Yeah. Yes, I didn't mention it. It was a somewhat separated part. If you work with a degenerate representation, you can forget about the real algebra AF, replace this by the C plus M2C plus M3C, and the physical content, let's say, doesn't change. You get the same gauge group, but the real algebra is a representation that is easier to describe, is less unpleasant than the complex algebra. It depends if you prefer this mix of real and complex things or stick to complex, the complex world, but use degenerate representations.
And that's a little bit also this result about this current algebra.
So when you compute things, the two algebras are equivalent because if you add the unity and you complexify the other, you get the same thing. But complexifying and adding the unity doesn't change the one forms because, okay, complexifying changes the one forms, but not the commutant inside the complex linear endomorphism. So are in some sense harmless changes to the algebra.
I understand, but the point was that you use still the grading money for different. I mean, you still use the chi,
yes,
for some things and gamma f for other things.
Well, you don't have gamma f, you only have a projector.
No, but you use gamma f in your.
Okay,
right?
You don't need to mention projector. Gamma f. You have gamma phi, you have the internal grading, and then you have a projector.
Yeah, but for this result, you use gamma f.
Yes.
So,
for the projector?
No, for this Morita equivalence.
So it should be perhaps consistent to check what it produces.
Yeah.
So the point is that still you have to rotate. In the Euclidean case, if you put this into the action, so this is different from chirality, so you will get something different. But that is not the physical.
Particle quartz with anti-particle leptons.
Okay. You're saying that you just take wild fermions, for instance, and then you...
Yeah,
and
then you put them together in different ways. Now, the point is that, and this is not clear to me, but B minus L is something which appears in Patisserov.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually one of the... So some breakings of SO10, there is B minus L appearing, and it's also gauged. Now, the appearance of this B minus L in this game, whether it's connected to that one and Patisserov, and then things would get together in a very more profound way, I looked at it and nothing obvious came to mind, but probably one has to look at it more deeply. Because B minus L, actually, you probably didn't even mention B minus L in the paper, no, Francesca?
Sorry?
No,
this is this is not the form you see it in the paper.
Yeah,
in the paper, simply, yeah, yeah.
Because I know that there is B minus
yeah, yeah.
L, and I notice that this is B minus L, because in the paper it's just...
You change the sign on the quark sector to the chirality.
By chance that...
But there is a scalar interaction between quarks and leptons in this model, so...
Yeah, the, no. The, so calling it B minus L, or just giving the matrix as I did, is just a more compact way of writing a matrix. At this level, very profound.
Okay, maybe we can continue during, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.